Maddie.
I'm Greg, and all together now,
we are live!
And we are taking over the Royal Society's Summer Showcase. Yeah. Yeah. It's ours now, Royal Society.
Yeah, but Greg, they have actually sort of, they've invited us. They've asked us to come along and bring some of our activities from our Let's Go Live show.
That is that is true, but still.
He loves a sound effect.
Yeah, I love a sound effect.
Yeah, but they have only given us about 30 to 40 minutes, so we need to, you know.
We should probably first explain what Let's Go Live is, this little thing is. So it's our live family science show that we do here from our spare room.
Welcome.
On our own little corner of YouTube.
Yeah, every show is jam-packed with fun facts, makes, activities, experiments, quizzes, and we love a theme. We've actually done over 85 live shows now, and we cover topics such as superheroes, theme parks, magic, spies.
So many different themes. As Maddie said, today the Royal Society has kindly invited us along to take over Summer Science and to show you three of our favourite science experiments. We've chosen a little trio of the most popular ones from our science website. This is our science activities website. If you want to go and check it out, those are free activities.
Over 100 activities on there now.
What?
I know, so many. But coming up in the show today, we're going to be baking some gooey chocolate mug cakes.
Yes.
Then we're going to be doing a step-by-step flower dissection.
Love it.
And we're making a solar system that you can fit in your pockets.
How is that even possible, I hear you ask? We'll show you soon. Also, cake. Excellent. Yeah. Always happy when there's cake. We have a bonus summer science mini quiz for you as well.
Mini quiz.
That's coming up. But before we get started, we always like to say hello to some of you who are watching live. So let's have a look what you're up to. Also, hello to everyone who's watching back later.
Yes.
I'm sure there'll be lots of you. If you are watching live, say hello, give us your name. Tell us where you are.
We love to give you shout outs on this show. So why don't you let us know in the comments? Have you been up to any summer science activities yourself?
What have you been doing?
Perhaps you've been on a walk and you've seen some interesting plants.
Have they been pond dipping rock pooling?
Yeah, maybe some of you have been to the beach already this summer.
Two of my favourite things.
Let us know. Do we have anybody here now?
We have got Olivia. Hello, Olivia. We've got Grace in Kent. Hello.
Hi to Henry in Waltham Cross. Hi, Waltham Cross.
Looking forward to seeing some of their favourite Let's Go Live makes. Hello to the Parkinson clan as
Hiya.
Well.
Amelia in Newmarket says, hello, Maddie and Greg. Hi,
Zoe
Amelia.
And Alice are watching. They're new.
Hello.
Welcome, welcome, welcome.
Oh, it's
welcome.
Lovely to have lots of you with us today right now.
And of course, hello to all of you watching back.
But as this is a summer science celebration, we thought we could kick some things off with an activity that might get you out and about enjoying the summer flowers.
Yeah, we love this one. We're going to start with a flower dissection. Now, the best part is, if you want to try this at home, all you need is a flower.
Hey!
Yeah, easy.
Actually, a pair of scissors can come in handy too. But if you are going to need some scissors, you might want a grown-up to help you.
Yeah.
Just so you know. The flower we're using, though, is this beautiful lily. And we were lucky to be able to pick this from our garden this morning, which is great news because a lily works really well for this activity because you can actually see all the parts really clearly.
When we did this on Let's Go Live, we did it in spring. So we used a daffodil.
Yeah.
It's also great with tulips
as
well. Yeah. So loads of options, loads of options. And if you decide to give this a go, you could get a flower from the garden or the park or like a cut flower
from the shops.
But probably wise to check with a grown-up before you go chopping flowers off from the garden.
Yeah, and something else that's important is don't go picking any wildflowers either.
No, we like the wildflowers. Why?
Yeah, because that's the bees need them. The pollinators
need them.
Leave them be wild and wonderful.
Leave them be for the bees.
But a flower like this is absolutely fine.
Okay.
Now, the idea of a flower dissection is to get a really good look at all of the parts of a flower, which is why a lily is a good one to use, because we can see everything very clearly. But to help us see even closer today, we're actually going to use our special magnifying camera. That's this little gadget here.
Yes, love it. Okay. Are we ready to go to the magnifying camera? It makes little things look bigger.
All right, we're just going to do a little test to start with.
Yeah, all right. All right, then. A little look at a bit of the flower.
I tell you what, why don't we start by looking at the flower as a whole and then we can use the magnifying lens on one of the outside parts, the petal.
Deal. How about that? Okay, so we're going to have a look at it and the thing that we want to look at the most, I guess, is pollination. So the bits that that is used to pollinate the flower. What does pollination mean? Pollination is what happens to a flower so that it can make seeds and then grow into new plants.
Yeah, Yeah, so pollination is really important, and most plants, most flowers need some help doing that. And that's where pollinators come in. I'm sure some of you could shout out some pollinators right now.
Already mentioned these are your favourites.
The bees, yeah, animals, insects, bats are very good pollinators, uh-huh. Small mammals as well. Mm. But they come along and they help a flower to get pollinated.
Yeah.
But for a flower to do that, it has to attract a pollinator to come along and visit it. So that's why we're going to look at the very first thing here we can see, and that is the petals. And the job of the petals is to attract the pollinators. They're like a big sign saying, hey, hey, come and look at me.
Also, look at the shape here. Mm. So you see, it's like a trumpet almost. If we look from the side, yeah, it's like there's the front and then you're going to go down here. So what's happening is these petals around the outside here,
yeah,
they're guiding the pollinator in. Mm-hmm. It's like a little tunnel.
Yeah.
And then actually at the bottom,
right
at the bottom,
is where you would find a liquid called nectar. So that's right at the bottom there. And that is the sweet, sticky liquid that animals like bees love. But you'll notice that to get to that nectar that pools at the bottom of the base of this flower, they have to sort of squeeze their face past all of this business that's going on here. So that's what we're going to look at.
So a bee would have to be like, okay, I want that nectar at the bottom.
Yeah.
All the way in.
Which is very clever because that's exactly what the flowers want the animals to do to pollinate them.
Okay, let's bring the microscope camera up.
All right,
and let's start having a look at what the bees need to squeeze past.
Okay, all right. So what should we look at? We should say as well, careful with lilies because they're pollen, it stains.
Yes, and also they're toxic for cats.
Yes.
So if you've got any friendly felines around, yeah, make sure they're away from lilies.
All right, so why don't we take a look at some of this business in here? We've had a look at the petals and we've seen how they attract the pollinators in the first place. But can you see these little dangly bits around the outside? Those parts are called filaments. And on the end of the filaments are anthers. They look like little fluffy pads. But we're going to use the magnifying lens to get a really close-up look at the anthers. And you can tell me what you're seeing. Here we are.
Oh, yeah. Come on, let's focus. Oh.
Can you see that? How about that? What do you think we're looking at right now? That is, what is it? Those are grains of pollen, mm-hmm, that are there sticking to the anthers.
Bees love pollen, mm-hmm, right? And when the bee pushes past these anthers, some of that pollen gets stuck to the hairs, the furry bits.
The fuzzy hairs.
The fuzzy hairs on the side of the bee. And then, mm-hmm, the bee takes that pollen,
yep,
from flower to flower. And when she actually gets to the next flower, she's got that pollen kind of, mm-hmm, stuck to her fluffiness.
Yeah.
Right? And then some of that gets rubbed off onto the next bit of the flower.
Yes. Which is, actually, if we go to the side camera here so we can show you, we've got these dangly bits around the edge. Those were the filaments with the anthers. But this longer part here, this is the style. And at the end of it, we have the stigma, this little tiny dot, which is very small, but hopefully I can show you on the magnifying lens. Can we get that in focus? Yes!
Oh,
there
nice.
We go. That is the stigma. So let's imagine our bee has got some pollen from another flower, has come along to this one, and in trying to get that nectar, it's going to brush some of that pollen off on this little tiny stigma. Now, after that's happened, the pollen grains will actually travel all the way down here to the base of the flower, which is all the way down there. And actually, when we put this part of the flower, this long stick, the style and the stigma and this bit at the base we're about to see, it's called the pistil. Mm. But shall we open up the flower to get a better look at what's down there at the base?
So down at the base, mm-hmm, is something that we call the ovary.
Yes.
So we are going to try to delicately break into this flower to see what's at the bottom of the pistil, mm, the bottom of that style.
So actually, I can probably show you all quite clearly here. So we can break away some of the petals like this first. So maybe if you were doing this at home, you could actually break apart the flower and then you could label all of the different bits.
Nice idea.
There we go. I'm just going to move that away so you can see it. So now you can actually really clearly see the filaments, the anthers, and then you've got the style, the stigma, this part of the pistil. But we're now going to open this bit up, and I'm going to use a pair of scissors to do that. So I'm going to be very careful. Remember to get a grown-up to help you if you do need any help. Right, let's see if I can cut this very carefully down the middle.
Watching fingers!
Okay, watching fingers very closely. There we go.
Okay, so you've chopped that bottom bit in half.
I have.
You've chopped the pistil open. Okay.
We're going to take a look on the magnifying camera again.
Okay.
And let's show you what we can see. Now, what can you see there, Gregs?
I can see some out-of-focus yellow.
Coming into focus. There!
Oh, wow. Okay, you lot watching. Can you see those little white bits?
Yeah, what are they?
Those little white bits are eggs.
Mm.
They're what we call the ovules. So the ovules are inside the ovary. And what happens is when the pollen from another flower makes its way down the pistil, right, from the stigma at the top and it goes all the way down, it gets to these ovules, these eggs at the bottom, and something called fertilization then happens.
Yes, and this really is how a seed gets made. So once these ovules have been fertilized, they will then start to swell up. Eventually the flower part will dry and die off. And then these that will have swollen up and become seeds can then drop onto the floor where they could potentially plant themselves and grow into new plants.
How amazing is that?
Yeah.
So we get new plants and flowers.
Yes.
Because bees are looking for their food, right? So we get new food because bees are going looking for their food, that nectar at the bottom, and they're wriggling in, and some of that pollen sticks to them, and then they buzz off, and they land on another one, and that pollen gets rubbed off, and then those little eggs turn into yet more plants. It's super cool.
And these flowers have evolved to attract pollinators, so all of this can happen.
I love that.
What did you think? What was your favourite part there of seeing all of those different bits of a flower? Do let us know in the comments if you're watching live with us right now.
We've got a bunch here.
Oh, great.
Oh my goodness, we've got so many.
Okay, Teddy, Helen and Danny all say hello and think they're going to be collecting flowers after this.
Awesome.
I hope so.
Amy in Swindon, whose birthday it is today.
Happy birthday.
Happy birthday. I don't have a birthday sound effect.
Happy birthday. Maddie and Greg, Hannah and Benji say hello. They love science and let's go live. Great to have you with us.
Emily and Owen are watching. Ooh. Evie and everyone at Rutherford House School.
Hi there. Hello from Camden and Ivy in Henley. Hello and to cousins Evie, Reuben and Joshua. Hi everyone.
And Grace, who's done some of our other activities, including our solar oven and made some yummy s'mores.
We like anything to do
that
with food,
one of our
don't we, really?
That flower side dissection, I love that.
It's good, isn't it?
So good.
Yeah.
Okay, that's our first one.
Yeah.
What was your favourite bit of it?
I think my favourite part has got to be seeing those teeny tiny ovules, those little eggs that will become the seeds. Because in real life, they're about the size of a pinhead.
Yeah.
You can see it with your eyes, by the way. You don't have to have a magnifying camera to
good
be
point.
Able to do that. But when you've got the camera, it makes those small things, you know, much bigger and easier to see.
Bridget and Miranda's favourite part as well.
Yeah.
Seeing the ovule.
Oh,
apparently.
Snap. Yeah. Snap, Bridget and Miranda.
And Olivia loved it when we saw the stigma really big and close.
Me too. I'm glad that I was able to just about keep that in focus.
We're going to play with scale a little bit more now, because that's what we've just been doing, right? We've been making little things much bigger.
Mm-hmm.
Now we're going to make something huge, something enormous, something gigantic.
Yeah.
Small enough
to
fit in your pocket.
Something so massive, it took Voyager 2, a spacecraft launched by NASA, travelling at the speed of 26,000 kilometres an hour.
It's this fast.
12 years to travel from Earth to the furthest reaches
of what we're talking about. The solar system.
Uh-huh.
Yes. Now, how big the solar system is, absolutely mind-boggling, right? For example, the distance from the sun to its closest planet, which is Mercury, that distance is almost 58 million kilometres. Okay. But the distance from the sun to the furthest away planet, Neptune, is something like 4.5 billion kilometres.
I mean,
how do you even imagine that?
It's really, really
how
hard
to get.
How do you
get your head around it?
You can't really. So to help us get a sense of that scale and the distance between all of the planets in our solar system, we're going to show you how to make a pocket-sized solar system.
Yes.
What do we need to do this?
All you need for this is a strip of paper.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so what we've done for this is we've taken an A4 piece of paper and we've ripped it in half.
Maybe.
But it doesn't actually matter what size bit of paper you've got. You're doing a little one. You're doing a really big one.
Yeah.
It's just, you know, if you want it to fit in your pocket, A4 is a good size.
Yeah. Most people have got a bit of A4 paper lying about. Scrap paper will do.
Maddie,
okay.
You are going to be the artist.
Okay.
All right. So you're going to get creative.
All right.
I'm going to use this top-down camera so we can actually see it.
Mm-hmm.
There it is. I feel I should do that. Dun 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 dun. Dum-dum-dum-dum-dum. This is
universal,
classic
someone's about to do art music.
Art music, gonna get creative. Okay, all right.
What am I doing?
First, I want you to fold it lengthways, yeah, in half. Perfect.
Okay, I have done that.
Good. And then again, please.
And again. Yes.
And then again, please.
And again.
So that's three folds.
Yes, Carol. Now. Okay. Open it back up again.
Yeah.
All right, so those three folds have got me 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 sections.
Okay, Koki. Now it's time to turn this into a map of the solar system. We're going to start by drawing the sun, okay? Mm-hmm. So we're going to draw the sun at one far end mm-hmm. of the bit of paper.
Mm-hmm. Over this side?
Please.
Is that good for you?
Great, love that.
All right, so I'm going to make this quite big, the whole length, because come on.
I'll tell you what, I'll chuck in a few little facts.
Ooh, nice.
As we go. Let's start with one. The sun,
yeah,
middle of our solar system, it's our star. Okay, so it's our nearest star.
Yeah. Okay, so sun is done.
Okay, right, halfway, the halfway point.
Yes.
You can always fold it in half again if that kind of helps to find which crease that is.
Mm-hmm.
You're going to draw Uranus.
Okay, so that's this part here. All right, yes. Then. I'm going to do Uranus in purple for no particular reason.
Okay, fun fact about Uranus.
Yes.
Most planets rotate like this, right, if that's the top of the planet. Okay, maybe at a slight angle, but most rotate like this.
Yeah.
Uranus rotates on its side.
Great fact. Right, the only planet in our solar system to do so.
Rotate on its side. Not like that, like us. On its side. You know what that's worthy of? A fact bomb.
Thanks.
Yeah, it is. All right, okay. So we've now got Uranus.
We do.
Halfway between Uranus
yep.
and the other end of the paper.
Yep.
Okay, draw Neptune.
Here. So Neptune is the furthest planet away from the sun.
Mm-hmm.
That also means it's the coldest.
It is.
So I'm going to do it an icy blue colour.
Love that.
How about that?
Love that. All okay, right. Now halfway between the sun and Uranus,
yep.
draw Saturn.
So that's here. And I think I've got an idea as to how I can make Saturn stand out.
If you like it, you need to put a ring on it. So
cheesy.
You need to put a ring around there.
Okay, so I've got the main planet and I'm just going to draw some little rings around Saturn. How about that?
Oh, that was a wonky one. Yeah.
There we
so
go.
Here's the thing. We look at those rings on photos or in a telescope, not a microscope, that'd be impressive. And you think they're solid rings, but actually they're made up of big rocks and little rocks and lumps of ice and dust. And they're yeah. actually, it's not a solid thing. It's loads of bits.
Whizzing around.
Okay, cool. Now, halfway between Saturn and the sun.
Yes.
You're going to draw Jupiter.
Okay.
Okay, so find that crease for me.
So that's, you might see it's just there.
Yeah, but then go a little way towards Saturn just a touch.
Here, all right
yeah,
then.
Cool.
So I'm actually going to make Jupiter pretty big. I mean, this isn't a scale in terms of size, is it? But
no.
It's good to give us a rough idea.
Yeah, exactly. Just to be clear on that one, this is a scale of the distance between the planets,
yes.
right? Not the size of the planets themselves. And I'm actually seeing Olivia said, where are all your fruit planets today, Greg? Because the first time we did this on Let's Go Live,
yeah.
we had all the, we actually did the scale of the sizes of the planets
yeah.
with fruit. Do you remember?
Yeah.
Raspberries, blueberries, giant watermelon.
Jupiter was a watermelon.
It was,
and
yeah.
I think Earth was a blueberry, to give you a sense.
Yeah, you can watch that back.
On Jupiter, I'm actually going to draw a red spot because... there has been a storm raging on Jupiter for about 350 years, I believe.
And the storm is wider mm-hmm. than our planet Earth. Just think about that. The storm is wider than our planet Earth.
Again. Okay, I've got Jupiter. What now?
Okay, cool. Perfect. All right, let's have a look at it. Okay, that looks really good. So now I want you to do is the first section.
Yes.
I want you to fold that in half.
Ooh, was not prepared for that.
A little bonus fold.
Okay, cheeky bonus fold.
And along that fold, you're going to add
yeah.
an asteroid belt.
Ooh, okay.
So loads of just little dots.
Couple of little dots for our asteroid belt.
Look how
belt.
Beautifully organised they are.
I'm trying to make them a bit more random.
Okay, now the next bit is a real challenge.
Right, what have I got to
so
do?
So the next bit, that gap between the sun and the asteroid belt.
Yeah.
Okay, you need to fit Mercury, Venus, Earth and Mars.
Four rocky planets.
Mercury, Venus, Earth and Mars.
Okay, so Mercury is the planet closest to the sun, so I've done that one.
Yeah.
Then we've got Venus, which is actually our hottest planet.
Yes, so good fact. Good fact, Matt.
So I'm
Mercury is the
next.
Closest to the sun, but Mercury actually isn't the hottest planet. Venus is the hottest planet.
And then we've got Earth, Mercury, Venus, Earth, so I'm going to make that blue because we often are known as the blue planet after all. Oh, I've got to make it very small.
Mercury, Venus, Earth.
And then Mars.
Then Mars.
And what colour do we know Mars as? We call it the red planet. Yeah. Done. Oh, just about squidged them in. Goodness me.
And you there, Maddie. You have done it.
goodness.
You have successfully made a map of the solar system. But you know what you need to do now?
What do I need to do?
Before we actually do it, just look at this. Look how close they are.
I had no idea that these four rocky planets are this close together in comparison with the rest of the planets in our solar system. Mm. No wonder Neptune's cold. Look
it's
at it.
All alone.
Isn't it?
It's all alone at the edge of the solar system.
I've now got to do the final thing, which is, of course, wrap it up.
Nice.
Here you go. There's a solar system for you.
Put it in my pocket.
Great.
I'm off on a little trip. Not going to get lost, am I? All right, see ya.
Bye. Bye. Don't go far. See you in 12 years if you're heading to Neptune on Voyager 2. Bye.
I'm not really going. Well, or did I go and come back? Ooh. Time dilation. All right, cool. We should also say that the planets are never actually going to line up like this.
No.
Right? You're never actually going to get them in a perfect line.
No.
Like that. But it's just something we can show you them. What they actually do is they travel in squashed circles that we call ellipses on a path that we call orbits.
Yeah, they're orbiting
so
around
they're orbiting
the sun.
Orbiting around the sun.
Don't mind, I'm just tidying up my pens.
Thanks. Give it a go.
Yeah, try it. Maybe if you get a bit more creative, do it on some black paper perhaps.
Great idea with chalk.
But, you know, make your own solar system in your pocket and show it to your friends, and maybe together you can name and label the planets as well. That's something else you could do.
Let's see what they're saying in the live chat.
Alrighty.
Let's see what they're saying. Oh, can we start with a joke?
Yeah.
Thank you, Sue. How do you organise a party in space?
Your planet. Teddy says the solar system was one of their absolute favourite Let's Go Lives. That's nice of you doing that again today.
Space Week.
James and Erin say hello. Hi, James and Erin.
Emma and Jack are really excited about a pocket-sized solar system. They're always making solar system and planet-sized comparisons. Amazing.
Atticus is watching with his mummy in the New Forest. Hi, Atticus.
Meredith is loving the show.
Ah, thanks, Meredith. And James, who's 7 years old, is loving the solar system map as well. Hi, James.
We're having a lot of fun with our
Royal
Society
good.
Takeover. Two activities down.
Yes.
One to go.
Yeah. So
plus a little bonus quiz.
Oh, yeah. We've still got that as well. Well, so far we've had a little bit of botany.
We have.
We've just dabbled in astronomy.
We have indeed dabbled away. Yeah.
What's next?
I think we go chemistry
next.
I think we are going to go for a tasty little chemistry experiment.
Yeah, we're making cakes.
Love cakes.
Certainly a tasty thing, yeah.
What better way to end our show than with a mug of cake and a slice of tea?
Wait.
Hang on, a mug of cake and a slice. But we are making mug cakes.
Hey!
we are making mug cakes, yeah. And I know you're saying, come on, Greg, come on, Maddie. How is making cakes a science experiment? I promise it is. Okay, it is. Honestly.
Yeah,
it is seriously a brilliant chemistry experiment. What we're going to do is we're going to work out what each ingredient in our recipe does for the cake.
That's the idea.
And we're going to make this a fair test, which means we need more than one cake.
Yeah, we need to make four.
Oh, no. Oh. We need to make four cakes.
No.
Oh, it's two each for a little Saturday treat?
For science. We will do it
for
Nabbit.
For science. Okay, cool.
We've got all of the ingredients ready to go.
Alrighty.
Which is here. So if I pop this up here and actually I can zoom you out a little bit so you can see what we're doing. Bingo.
All right.
There we go. Now you can see.
Okay, great. So here's the thing. I think we're going to start by making one mug cake with all of the ingredients.
Yes.
Okay. Then we're going to do three more mug cakes. And each one, we're going to take out one of the ingredients.
Yes.
Deal?
Yeah, that sounds good.
But because it's
a
fair test, because every science experiment needs to be a fair test, we are going to leave everything else the same.
Exactly.
So first one is our control. Mm-hmm. Everything, all the ingredients. Second one, we'll take out one ingredient.
Yep.
Next one, we'll take out a different ingredient. Next one, a different ingredient.
And then we can look at the final baked mug cakes.
And taste them.
And by looking and tasting, we should get a better idea of the role those missing ingredients play.
Yes.
That's the idea. Yes. Before we do any baking, we do need to clean our hands because I was touching those lilies earlier. If you're doing this at home, then of course, give your hands a wash with soapy water. We've just got some hand sanitizer.
Okay.
I'm going to take you through our recipe for a chocolate mug cake.
Yes.
But there are tons of mug cake recipes online. Have a look. See what you like best. This is just our one, so I'll guide you through it. So let's head to our ingredients, Greggs. In this mug, I already have 4 tablespoons of plain flour. Oh, thank you. And I'm now going to add 1 teaspoon, so that's a level teaspoon of cocoa to the mug. There we are. I'm now going to add 2 tablespoons of vegetable oil, which is going in. 2 tablespoons of vegetable oil. There we are. We can add 2 tablespoons of water. We'll start to see a theme here with the 2 tablespoons measurement. So that's 1 and another tablespoon of water. Nice. What else do we need? 2 tablespoons of caster sugar is going in next. 2 tablespoons of caster sugar.
I see one thing peeking out that we haven't used yet.
That's 2, actually. Oh, I've got a quarter of a teaspoon of baking powder, which I'm going to add. So that's a quarter of a teaspoon there, like so. And then the last thing is an egg. So we've got 1 egg left. I'm just going to sort of twist that round so I can get a better angle at it. 1 egg, in it goes.
Small egg, good for that one, isn't it?
Yeah, because it's only a little mug, so if you can get small eggs, that'd be great. Now, the last thing I'm doing is stirring it all up really, really well. And this bit's quite important because you don't want to have any lumpy bits of flour. That's not what we want, is it, at all?
No.
So you're going to help me stir this as well.
Want me to do a bit of mixing?
Yeah, I'm still. It takes a surprising amount of time.
It does,
to get it all well incorporated, well mixed, but it's important.
It's important because you need to mix all those ingredients together so that they can be ready to react together, right? Because what's going to happen is we're going to put it in the microwave. That's why we've got the microwave in the back of the spare room here. and that microwave is going to give the energy to the to fuel, to give the energy for that chemical reaction. And that chemical reaction is going to transform the sloppy mixture into a delicious cake. Told you, science.
We're actually going to put it, you have a stir now, we're going to put it in the microwave for a minute. Depending on your microwave, you might need 45 seconds or a minute and a half. But you know when the mug cake's done, when it starts to lift up out of the mug a little bit and pull away from the sides. It might still look a bit squidgy, but if you overcook it, things start to taste eggy. So it just takes a bit of practice. I think we're good.
I think we're done.
That's it. So you can now see the final mixture. There it is.
I think we're done. Okay.
How does that look?
I'm out of breath.
Perfect.
Oh, does it count as exercise? Cooking.
Right. Shall I put it in the microwave?
Put it in the microwave.
Ooh, nice. Yep. So I'm going to do a minute to start with and then we'll adjust and see how it's looking.
Okay. Good thinking.
Okay.
Now, we have good news for you. We can strike that one. And what we've done is we have actually prepared our 3 other cakes.
Here's some we made earlier.
Here they are. And you can see we have taken 1 ingredient out of each.
Mm-hmm. So this one, we have not added any baking powder. This mixture, we've left out the egg. And in this mixture, we've left out the vegetable oil.
But because it's a fair test, right, all the other ingredients are the same.
Yes.
So the same amount of flour, same amount of sugar, same amount of water, same amount of cocoa powder.
Mm-hmm.
But if you wanted to, right, and importantly, if you've got enough people to eat all this cake, because we don't like food waste, do we?
No.
Then you could try it where you take out those other ingredients.
Yeah, what happens if you leave out the flour or the sugar or the cocoa powder?
Yes.
Well, then you'd probably just have a plain cake.
True.
It might affect something else.
Actually, lots of the Let's Go Live viewers, they got really into this experiment. They were doing all sorts of different types of cake. Hello. Let's see how it's looking.
Oh, hello. Beautiful.
Oh, it's raised up, just like you said it would.
Beautiful. Look at that.
Do you think that's done? Should we have a look on the side camera?
Ah, yes. That's great.
Do you think that's done?
That's great. I might give it another 15 seconds.
Sure.
Just to be extra sure, because I can't see the bottom of it.
Sure, why not? Why not?
You know
really
what?
Important, once you've brought it out, you need to let it cool.
Yes,
okay,
it's
don't
quite
just
warm.
Get in there with your hands. It's going to, of course, it's be hot. It's going to come out of the microwave, so let it cool down.
But we've actually got to cook all of these. Mm. So I think we might need to do a little something to while away the time.
What could we do to while away the... This is the quiz music, by the way. If you've never joined us for a Let's Go Live, we always do a quiz. We have to dance to the quiz music. What's today's quiz music? I'm going to be a flower.
Flower? I'm going to be a cake rising out of the mug.
B.
There it is. Okay, next one going
flower.
In. No baking powder.
Okay, cool. Right. 5 questions for a mini quiz for you, all right? they are all... multiple choice.
Yes.
They're inspired by some of our favourite kind of summary moments from Let's Go Live so far.
Yeah, let us know in the live chat how you're doing in the quiz, but don't put your answers in the live chat because then you might give them away to other people who are playing.
Yeah, just say whether, say whether you got it right.
Yeah.
And what your name is.
Yeah, and then we'll read out your name.
But no answers. No answers.
Should we kick things off with question number 1?
I'm so ready for question number 1.
By the way, it's already smelling of chocolate in here and it's delicious.
Oh, it's delicious.
Okay, so question number 1. This came from one of our Oceans Week episodes.
Mm.
This is a picture of a type of animal you might find in a British rock pool. Mm. But what is it? Is it A, a blenny, B, a limpet, or C, a sea beadlet anemone?
A blenny, a limpet, or a sea beadlet anemone?
Anemone.
Anemone. What's the answer?
A,
the
B,
answer
or C?
Is...
Was it blenny, limpet, or anemone? Ding! C. The answer is C.
It's an anemone. Anemone. Yeah, okay. While you do that, Mads, I'll tell them about it. So the underside of this animal's body acts like a sucker, holds them onto the rock, and they can actually move very slowly if they need to. And then they use their stinging tentacles to catch passing prey, but when the tide is out, they retract their tentacles, they suck them in, and they leave behind what basically resembles a blob of jelly.
Weird animals, aren't they?
Well done to a bunch of you in the live chat getting this right. Evelyn, Ela, Aria, so many of you. Well done, keep the names coming.
We've got a monster! We've created a monster!
We've created a monster!
That was no baking powder, I'm now putting in no egg.
Okay, question number two. Well done to Evangeline and Bridget and Miranda. They love rock pooling, so they got it right. Okay, question number two is, this is a picture of something that captures and converts energy into electricity. What is it?
Is it A, a hydro panel, B, a wind panel, or C, a solar panel? What do you think? Hydro panel, wind panel, or solar panel?
It is...
C!
It's a solar panel, yeah. Solar panels, they capture the energy from the sun and they convert it into an electric current that we use to power things.
Yes.
And we say that it's a renewable source of energy because it renews.
Yeah, it comes from the sun. It
doesn't run out.
Yeah, it replaces itself in a way. All right then, question number three.
Yeah.
What animal do you think left these tracks on a beach in the sand in the Bahamas?
Hmm. What animal was it? A, a horseshoe crab. B, a snake. Or C, a pig. Was it a crab, a snake, or a pig?
The answer is C. Those are pig tracks in the Bahamas. And that's because there is an uninhabited island in the Bahamas called Big Major Cay. And there's a beach there known as Pig Beach.
Pig Beach.
It's called that because there are some feral pigs who live there and they like to swim in the sea, walk along the sand.
That gull looks like it's on its back.
Is it? I can't quite tell.
I don't think it is. I think it's on the beach behind it.
Really?
But that makes me chuckle. All right, how are we doing?
Last cake.
Toby and Mummy got the previous one right. The solar panel, Evie and Wilf. Oh, they got them on their house. Super cool. James and Timothy, Nikhil, Evelyn got it right without even the answer. Yes.
Oh, well, yeah, well some done. Of you might be not even need the multiple choice. How about that?
Two questions left.
Mm-hmm.
Two questions left. Question number four is, this is a picture of an ancient Egyptian invention called a shadoof, which helped farmers water their crops. But what river might it be pulling water from?
It's an ancient
Egyptian invention.
So is it pulling water from A, the Nile, B, the Congo, or C, the Niger?
Hmm.
What do you think?
The Nile, the Congo, or the Niger? The answer is the Nile.
Yeah.
Here's a picture of the Nile. Look at that. Longest river in the world.
What I love about this photo is how you can see how the Nile water is feeding the land immediately around it.
That's a beautiful photo.
Cool, isn't it?
Love that.
All right, last one. This is question number five.
Well done to James and Tim and Teddy with the piggies. We've got loads coming through. Sammy got 3 out of 3.
Well,
was it 4 out of 4? Hannah and Benji doing well as well.
Well done.
People watching back, I'm sure you're smashing it. Sorry, smashing. Leo said the Nile. Good job, good job. Okay, last question.
So this was from...
It's a tricky one.
And it's done in the microwave as well. This was taken from our trees episode of Let's Go Live. Mm. But what is this growing on a tree? Do you think it's A, a pear, B, a cashew nut, or C, a pepper?
Mm.
Do you think you're looking at a pear, a cashew, or a pepper?
Mm. The answer is a cashew.
Yeah, B. How amazing. This is actually the cashew apple, which is the fleshy part of the cashew fruit. And actually, you can see the yellow bit, that's the fruit, that's the apple. And then there's sort of the green blob at the bottom. That is the nut. The nut is inside there.
How amazing is that?
Yeah, every time you eat a cashew nut, actually, it comes from one of those.
Incredible. That fact completely blows my mind. Every time. Right, all of our cakes have been cooked.
Should we take a look at them?
Yeah, we've just got to wait for that N1 to cool down, but we'll get to that one here at the end. So first things first, let's start with the cake.
Yep.
With all of the ingredients, okay?
How exciting.
So,
Shall I empty it out onto the tray so we can then see them all next to each other?
Thinking back.
All right, so I'm going to do that. Let's see if I can empty the... Oh, look. Now, that is looking exactly as you would hope a cake to look, I think.
Okay.
It's light, it's fluffy. Do you want a little taste?
Hang on.
Are you lifting it up?
Let's have a look at it in the close. Look at that. You can see, right? It's bouncy.
Yes.
It's got lots of air bubbles inside it.
Yeah.
A little bit of crumb holds together well.
Mm-hmm.
It's what we like to call a light, solid foam, aka a delicious cake.
It tastes like chocolate cake.
That's a delicious cake. Sorry. Don't eat with your mouth full and all that. That's a delicious cake.
Really good.
Okay.
Nothing wrong with that. That's working very well.
On with the experiment then.
So then what do you think might have happened? What do you predict has happened to the cake with no baking powder? Wow. Okay, well, that's very interesting. Really interesting indeed. I was wondering if I can lift this up for you. Here you go.
Oh.
Right. Yeah. Weirdly, it feels a bit like a bouncy ball.
Yeah, it's... Yeah. Shall I try it?
Well, you can try. You eat the other bit.
What's happened... For science.
It's gone really chewy. And the reason is because baking powder is a raising agent. That means it helps the cake to rise. We put in baking powder and that contains something called bicarbonate of soda. And bicarbonate of soda releases a gas called carbon dioxide. And it's that gas that makes a cake light and fluffy. So without the baking powder, we've ended up with something tough and chewy. Not good?
Not as good as the first one.
Really?
No. Okay so that shows us that the baking powder
contains
the bicarbonate of soda that makes the carbon dioxide that makes it fluffy.
Absolutely.
No fluff, squidgy.
Right, okay, next one? Got
it. Next one.
So this is the one with no egg. Again, make your predictions. What? Ooh.
Oh.
Oh.
Oh, this... Okay, cool.
Right, I'm going to taste it, though, because you can immediately see that the one with no egg... It's really crumbly, actually. Very crumb. Don't play with your food like this at home.
Science.
It's really crumbly.
Let me try some.
But that's actually because egg is a binding ingredient. We say that it binds, it holds all of the other ingredients together. And eggs, they're actually long chain molecules. So think of your fingers as long chain molecules like this. And in an egg, they're all tangled together. But when an egg is heated, those chains, they unravel and they form a firm structure, a little bit like a net.
Yeah.
And in a cake mix, that net helps to trap those bubbles of gas, that carbon dioxide.
That we got from the baking powder.
Right, but with no egg, we don't have that structure, so everything's just crumbled and fallen apart.
I tell you what, though.
Crumbly cake.
Delicious crumbly cake.
It is. It's almost tastier, actually.
You know what? I think it might be.
Do you prefer it?
I think I do.
Well, there you go. If you don't eat egg, you're in for a winner there.
Yeah.
So just skip the egg.
Yeah.
Last one.
Last one then.
I'm trying to keep this tidy. I don't know why. Last one is no oil. Let's see what's happened to this one. Oh, dear.
Oh.
Oh, that's very...
Can you cut into that one? Here you go, look.
Can you help me out? Ooh, it's quite dense.
Let me hold.
I'm going to try a little bit there.
Let me hold this one up. Okay. What was it like?
I have to say, it's really tough.
I have to actually cut this one with a knife and fork, which is hilarious.
That one could have done with a bit... It's a bit dry, isn't it?
It's dry.
And I would say it's really chewy, actually.
It's dry and chewy.
The reason it's dry is because oil will coat all of the other ingredients in a fatty layer, which stops them from drying out when they're cooked, when they're heated.
Hmm.
But the other thing is that when we use flour... In cakes, we often mix it with water, and that's to create something called gluten.
Gluten.
And gluten will make a cake, or bread. We use gluten a lot in bread. It makes it make something, I've got chocolate all over me.
Makes
something chewy and stretchy, which is great in bread.
But not in a cake.
No.
In a cake, you actually don't want much gluten.
No.
You deliberately... don't want it because gluten makes a cake tough and chewy.
Right. So the good thing about something like oil or fat is that actually slows down the production, the making of that gluten. we haven't had the oil in this mix, so the gluten has just gone and got itself all stretchy, and it's made the cake quite tough and actually not that tasty to eat.
Nope. Okay.
So that's our final results.
I love this experiment.
Me too.
Hopefully you're going to give this a go as well, so you can work out what each of these different ingredients does in a cake. Uh-huh. So therefore, that's the question really, Maddie. It's looking at these cakes,
right?
Which one would you want to eat? Obviously, we're going to eat them all because we don't like food waste, but which one would you want to eat?
I thought this one, no baking powder, was really not very nice at all. It was very chewy, as was no oil. This was chewy and dry. This one was crumbly, but very tasty. I think with maybe, I don't know, that's really, really good, actually. And of course, the one with all of the ingredients was pretty much a perfectly formed foamy cake. So I would say the one with all the ingredients does stand up. There is a reason for it.
Then.
All right.
You have that one. I'm going to have the one with no egg because I actually quite like this crumbliness.
Mm.
Have a go yourself at home. You know, maybe change another ingredient.
Yeah.
See what happens.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe change up the recipe altogether. Well done to the people who have spotted the fact that Greg tries them twice. Well, you know, for science.
Of course. Who else have we got in there?
Delicious.
Someone says the no oil cake looks like beef. It does.
Oh gosh, it does look a bit.
It does look a bit like.
Timothy says, "Will it work with ramekins in the oven?" Ramekins in the oven. Might do.
I have no idea. Give it a go.
Try one. See what happens. Try the normal one first.
Bridget and Miranda said that the egg helps things stick together. Well done. That's exactly right.
Sammy's done this.
Bridget
in brownies, which is very apt if you're making cake at brownies.
Yeah, yeah. Aria and Ella say hello, Maddie. Hello, Arianella.
Olivia and Jacob in Peterborough. Frankie can't wait for it.
Oh, great. Evelyn's got a joke as well.
Looks like a cup.
Cake.
But
we should head off.
Yeah. We should probably say ta-rah. Thank you so much for watching, you lot. It's been a pleasure. It's been fun. We can't say goodbye just yet, though. Thank you very much to the Royal Society for having us here to take over your YouTube channel.
We've had a really great time showing you some of our favourite activities, so do give them a try at home. If you do, ask a grown-up to take some photos, and you can always post them on social media and tag us so we can see what you have been up to.
Yeah, we'd love to see it. Also, if you're looking for more activities to do over the summer, then we've got our science activities website, which has 100 or so ideas currently. We're still uploading every week. It's all free, there's all the ingredients and all the resources, so go and have a look.
ingredients.
You know what I mean. They're listed. Or you can go to our YouTube channel. Our YouTube channel is here. Watch your head, Mads. Whoop. So that's where you can watch all the 85 shows of Let's Go Live so far. They're all up on there.
But it's not just our bits either. Do check out the rest of the Royal Summer Society's Summer Science Programme.
Royal Society's Summer Science Programme.
Summer Society. You know what you're watching.
They're also the Royal Winter Society. No.
But it also includes the interactive Summer Science Hub, where there are loads of demos, games and experiences. And you can find those at royalsociety.org/summer.
Yes.
And do explore the rest of the event programme as well, which includes a much longer, family-friendly, big summer science quiz on the YouTube channel too.
Oh, crikey. I've had such a fun morning. I hope you have a good rest of the weekend. If you're watching this back, I hope you've enjoyed it. We are off to go enjoy our mug cakes, our little Saturday treat. Until next time.
Stay curious.
Oh, should we send it?
Stay curious.
Bye, you lot.